Attack of the Final Girls is a podcast about the horror genre, so listener discretion is advised. Please check the show notes for specific content warnings for this episode, and of course, beware of spoilers.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Attack of the Final Girls. I'm Teresa.
And I'm Juliet.
And we're on our every 2 week journey. It feels like it's been a long time since we recorded, but
I think it has. I mean, a lot of life has happened in the time since we last recorded, I think.
Which is weird because to our listeners, it won't be any different.
Yeah.
Time is relative.
It is.
It means nothing.
It is everything and nothing.
But we are talking about, I think this is our first Tarantino movie.
Yes.
Yeah. We're talking about From Dusk Till Dawn from 1996 with Mr. Tarantino himself and George Clooney and little baby Juliette Lewis.
Yeah.
And Harvey Keitel.
Yes. All the folks. And of course, Danny Trejo, who we all love, and Salma Hayek, who we all love.
And Tom Savini.
Yes.
Who in real life nobody loves, but in movies everybody loves. No, I don't know. I've never actually had a personal encounter with Tom Savini. I've just heard a lot of shit about him. Just that he's like kind of grumpy.
Yeah.
Maybe he's just bored. He's one of those people that like when he gets bored, he gets grouchy.
Maybe.
And he can't cover it like a toddler.
I've heard he's a good sport.
Okay. That's fair.
Yeah.
That's fair.
I've heard that he can come off a little grouchy, but he's actually a very good sport.
As the daughter of a very, very, very grouchy, crotchety asshole of a man, that doesn't scare me. Bring it, Tom Savini. Your grumpiest is a cakewalk, I promise you. But yeah, this is Tarantino, Robert Rodriguez combination, of which there are so many before and after this movie. They have had a long collaboration partnership over the years. They teamed up for the Grindhouse movies, Planet Terror and Death Proof. Death Proof was more of a Tarantino thing. Yep. Planet Terror was more of a Rodriguez thing. But they teamed up together and did a bunch of stuff. And then they've had some collaborations since then, too. They also have like this cadre of actors that they both borrow from. There's a Venn diagram. Some of them overlap when they're in both types of movies, and some of them are in exclusively one or the other.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if Uma Thurman's ever been in a Rodriguez film.
Not that I can think of, but I could be wrong about that.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
But like Harvey Keitel, he's in both. Salma Hayek.
Yeah.
So yeah. It's a very easy movie to talk about because I've, like, at this point, I think between the two of us, we've seen it about a kajillion times.
Yes.
But if you haven't seen this movie, it's from 1996. It's about two criminals and their hostages unknowingly seek refuge in a truck stop populated by vampires. It says with chaotic results, but I'm going to amend that and say, and chaos ensues.
Correct. That is the only way.
The like second half, or maybe like the last 60%, is solidly a horror movie.
Yes.
But the first 40% kind of tricks you into thinking that this is a movie like Desperado is, where it's, you know, revenge slash crime movie across the vast wasteland of the West, headed towards Mexico and freedom. And there's some really bad things that these brothers have done, and they're trying to get away from them. And then it turns into a vampire movie.
Yeah, it's kind of fun. I don't know how easy it is to pull off now, but I can remember back in, you know, more of the physical media days when this was still, you know, kind of had a cult status, and you would have people every once in a while that didn't necessarily fully comprehend what this movie was. And so you could kind of watch their reaction when the vampire action starts. Like, wait, what's happening right now? I don't know if that's even still possible today in the era of, you know, the internet and streaming, et cetera, et cetera. But I always recall that being a really fun part of this movie is just that turn, that moment when you're like, oh, this is not at all what I thought it was.
Oh, yeah. In the pre-IMDb days, or the days when you didn't have the internet readily available on your phone to look something like this up, I remember the first time I watched it. I had seen other Tarantino movies before. I had seen Desperado before. So in the first part of this movie, I'm thinking this is going to be sort of like Desperado, a little different. And then, you know, Salma Hayek turns into a snake vampire. I'm like, wait, what? What is happening right now? Once they get to the titty twister in general, I'm like, okay, this movie's a little different, but
yeah,
but you got to have a good bar to have a shootout in.
Yeah, exactly.
And
exactly.
that's what I'm thinking is going to happen is like this cool bar. There's Salma Hayek doing a sexy dance, which mm-hmm. is like very Tarantino.
Yeah.
Which we'll talk about that more.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm like, okay, all right, I get it. Everything's good. And then she turns into a vampire. I'm like, what is happening?
Yeah. And very specifically turns into like a creepy made up prosthetic snake person vampire. Like if you just told me like, oh, Salma Hayek in that costume vampire, I'd be like, yes.
Duh.
Sexy Salma Hayek, you know, yeah, sure. Okay. You know?
Yeah.
But the fact that they went with that transformation into, you know, the more prosthetic, I always think of it, although this obviously came before that, as Buffy vampires.
Oh yeah, me too.
You know, where they have like the kind of scrunched up faces and the weird noses and the big prosthetic pieces on their faces. They went in that direction with this movie, which is in part because the original story idea actually came from Robert Kurtzman.
Okay.
And he paid Tarantino to like take the idea and write a script about it. And part of the reason that he wanted to do it was for himself and Greg Nicotero to show off their effects.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they definitely did that.
Yes.
They definitely showed off their prowess in practical effects because the practical effects in this movie are awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I agree with you about the Buffy thing. Every time I see them, I'm like, the noses are a little tiny bit different because they go more with like the bat nose
yeah.
in this one than they do in Buffy. But they have like the heavy brows, the extra like jawline mm-hmm. stuff. Very, very, very Buffy the Vampire Slayer. In fact, the transitions even like look like Buffy when they transition into being the vampires.
Yeah.
It really reminds me of the Master.
Yeah.
It reminds me of him. And his transformation, like changing the face, changing stuff, or like mm-hmm. when Spike turned into a vampire,
or like Darla.
Yes, yeah, yep. I'm all about that. I love a practical like. I know we're in 2024 and we're like miles away from that. You know those transitions and stuff, but they still hold a special place in my heart.
Well, and they still look pretty good, honestly. There were a couple of things that because I was watching it very closely this time, there were a couple of effects that I clocked as looking a little dated, but not many. Like the vampire suits still look great. They would look great in a movie now, you know. The vampire prosthetics, like all of the prosthetics and things look great. Really, it was just some of the transformations where you could tell they were using some primitive digital effects mm-hmm. to enhance the transformation scenes. Those were the ones that looked the clunkiest to me, and that makes sense because digital effects more than practical tend to look really dated.
Oh, for sure. And some of the kill sequences too. Yeah. This was like a really high level thing. And thank goodness they did this because I think it paved the way for a lot of vampire movies to come is that they went with a digital sequence to kill the vampires for them to kind of like melt.
Yeah.
Because they some of them catch on fire. Some of them just like kind of melt. They like dissolve and mm-hmm. then they turn into a puddle of goo. But that was all done practically too. I should say the effects were done practically, but the transition was done
yes.
digitally. So those can look kind of rough, but I don't even care.
Because
I'm just yeah. like, yeah, this is, I mean, it's a movie from 1996. I'm not going to like hold it up to a super, this isn't a Marvel movie, so.
No, and I feel like honestly, those melty effects really like paved the way for like the true blood, like a vampire yes. gets staked and like explodes or exactly. implodes into a pile of goo. Like, you know, this movie's effects had to walk for True Blood to really run with that whole thing.
Very true. Yeah. And I'm glad that they did it because if they hadn't, like, I think John Carpenter's Vampires came out like either shortly after this or maybe the year after. And those transitions too, like, they look kind of rough, but who cares? It's a movie we all had come to love at this point. I remember John Carpenter's vampires looking like pretty similar to mm-hmm. this. So somebody's got to crawl for everybody else to be able to run. So
it's true.
It's okay. And like, if you're not concentrating super hard on the transitions, I think everybody can appreciate the effects.
Yeah.
Because the other thing is the vampires towards the end of this movie, the vampire suits that they're wearing, that when the bats all come in and then they kind of turn into like human-esque vampires. I don't know how that works, but whatever. They don't give us an explanation. We don't need one at this point.
Really, yeah.
They all use like practical suits for those mm-hmm. vampires. And I read that they only had 6 of them. So anytime you see one vampire get killed, they immediately like respawn as another vampire because they only had a certain number of suits because they were really expensive. They took a really long time to apply. So imagine if you had like 100 people in those and how many man hours that would take to like apply that makeup.
Oh, I can't even imagine.
And maintain the suits and make the suits because they're all latex. Instead, they were like, how about we just do 6 and clone them.
Yeah.
Copy and, you know, and clone.
You don't even notice that. You know? Like, I think in some movies you can kind of notice when something is being reused, but in this case, like, not at all. I think it's a combination of the suits being interesting enough that they could get so many different angles that it didn't look, you know, like the same thing over and over again. And also the direction. Like, they were very smart with the editing and the cutting and the angles they were choosing. So you never felt like, oh, there's only 6 of them.
Yeah, exactly. There are, in fact, parts where they do clone the vampires, and they do it in such a way that it doesn't look like totally campy and awful.
Yeah.
It looks just campy enough to be charming.
Yeah, exactly.
But not campy enough where you're like, wow, this movie probably just was straight to home video.
Mm-hmm.
Because it wasn't. This movie was not.
Right.
It was a critical failure. However, it has totally reached a cult status at this point. And obviously, it never hurt the fame of George Clooney or Quentin Tarantino, not even in the slightest amount. And, like, Danny Trejo went on to be the actual, like, lead of Robert Rodriguez's, like, dream action project, mm-hmm. Machete. So, and I love Machete. I'll watch a movie 1,000 times.
Oh, yeah.
It's so much fun.
Yeah.
And, the second half of this movie, you can definitely see Robert Rodriguez is like, yes, more explosions, more fire, mm-hmm. more guns. Everything needs to blow up. Where are the car explosions? Where are the car chases? He doesn't have that in this movie, but you can tell he wants it.
Yeah. Yeah. You can definitely see this paving the way for like Planet Terror, especially.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know. I love this movie. There are certainly problems with it.
Yeah.
It's a product of 1996. Quentin Tarantino was kind of a loose cannon in 1996. I mean, maybe he still is a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, if we think about Django Unchained, he kind of still is a loose cannon. He doesn't play by the rules. People are like, hey, you can't say those type of things. You probably shouldn't say those type of things. It's not exactly very, you know, nice to say those type of things or appropriate or whatever. Like, you could say literally anything else. And at this point, he just has said, like, no, I don't give a shit. There's definitely racist language in this. There is ableist language in this. And it's not nice, but it's also an older movie. It's 30 years old.
Yeah, it's interesting. The thing that kind of bothers me when I think about Tarantino is, like, okay, so in 1996, there are a lot of things in the dialogue for this movie that they weren't nice then either, mm-hmm. but were far more common. Like, I'm thinking of some of the ableist language, especially. Like, unfortunately, that was just a part of kind of the way that a lot of people talked back then. Not to justify it, it was what it was back then. And we have since learned, like, hey, not cool. Let's avoid these words. And, you know, these words are really harmful to other people. So I feel like, on the one hand, it wouldn't bother me as much if I was just like, well, this sucks, but it's a film from 96. That language was more acceptable back then. But my problem tends to get into the fact that, like, Tarantino has not learned and grown along with us, and that he seems to get a pass in a lot of regards. And, like, I think that's the thing that bothers me about him as a filmmaker the most is, like, I see other directors being taken to task for some of their use of language, especially. And people seem to, like, still do, like, the, you know, genius man thing with him, where they're like, but he's Tarantino, and that's just his style, and he was influenced by the grindhouse. And, like, I don't care, you know? All of those things can be true, but, like, how come he gets a pass and everybody else, not that I want everybody else to get a pass, but, like, he should not be getting a pass.
No, especially with the level of movies that he's making and the fact that the reason why he gets a pass is because he's a part of the white boy club in Hollywood of male directors who are allowed to do whatever they want because people think that they're auteurs or something, when in reality, they're just, like, too influential, I would say. it's kind of a too big to fail thing.
Yeah.
Where if somebody's like, hey, Tarantino, you really can't use the N word, then all these folks will jump on this bandwagon and say, well, he can because this is a period piece and this is how mm-hmm. people would talk. And it's like, okay, but what about all of the other movies that are made around this time that don't use that word?
Right.
Or give it the gravity
yeah.
of the language rather than just like a throwaway, like a tossaway term.
Mm-hmm.
That is the thing I have a problem with. I definitely am not going to defend Tarantino as a person.
Yeah.
Because I think he's kind of a piece of shit.
Yeah.
I mean, not kind of a piece of shit. He is a piece of shit. However, some of the dialogue in Tarantino movies is among my favorite dialogue.
Sure.
Any movie I've ever seen.
I mean, yeah.
In certain instances, there are scenes when he will write dialogue that just like is so moving. I mentioned to you while we were watching this, one of my favorite scenes of all time in any movie is the scene with Christoph Waltz talking to the dairy farmer in Inglourious Basterds.
Yeah.
I love that scene. Maybe Tarantino didn't even write it. If that's the case, cool. I'm totally down with that. There's nothing special that happens. It's not filmed in any particular way. There's mm-hmm. no special lighting. There's nothing special to it. It's just Christoph Waltz interrogating this French dairy farmer. But the dialogue is so good that it totally draws you in and makes you really want to watch it.
I mean, to me, that is actually what makes him even more infuriating as a writer, is he is capable of really good, smart stuff. And he falls back on and double downs on just like harmful language, lazy writing, in my opinion. Like, I've said that about a lot of his like post Kill Bill stuff. Like, mm-hmm. I feel like it's lazy and it's self-indulgent. And I'm just like, he actually is, you know, personal complicity and all the Weinstein stuff, et cetera. If we're just taking him as an artist, he is a very talented person. And it's almost more infuriating that it's like, you are capable of being better than this. And yet you're just like doubling down on being kind of a brat, in my opinion. And just being like, well, I get to say what I want. Wah, wah, wah.
Right.
It's like, no, but you can write good, compelling stuff. Do that instead.
Yeah, it's like it's for shock value
yeah.
at that point.
Yeah.
It's only doing that. Like, he does that in Pulp Fiction.
Yeah.
There's a scene in Pulp Fiction, which I vehemently disagree with. There's several scenes in Django Unchained when I'm like, this could be a really good movie. You don't have to do this. You don't yep. have to write like this.
Yep,
it's
exactly.
not necessary. We get it. We understand what the era is. We don't need you to beat us over the head with it over and over again.
It's the Rob Zombie problem all over again.
Yes.
Where it's like, actually, like, you have good ideas here and the audience is smart enough to understand what you're trying to do. Like,
you don't have to accentuate everything with the F-bomb.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. That's kind of frustrating. Is
yeah.
that it's just disappointing when you're watching a movie and you're getting into it and then the director says something like that and you're like, cool. Nice.
Yeah.
Like, okay, well, I guess I just have to sit there with it. And then you're kind of embarrassed. Like, if you end up liking it, you're like, I like it, but
yeah,
should I? Like, because there are some folks who will hear something like that in a movie and then immediately turn it off. And they're
yeah.
like, I'm not gonna buy into this. And that's totally fair. Like,
yeah,
that's the way that you handle listening to movies and dialogue like that. That's absolutely your right to do that. And like, I will never fault anybody for saying like the language totally turned me off and I can't watch it.
Yeah, fair enough.
Like, yeah, totally. I mean, I'm sure that there would be certain parts of language like that I would listen to and be like, no, I'm not doing mm-hmm. this, you know, mm-hmm. and just like completely can't watch it. So I will never fault anybody for that. And I agree with you, like, it's that much more infuriating because you're like, I know that you're a good writer. I know that
right.
you can write the shit out of some dialogue. So why do you have to use such foul, juvenile, mm-hmm. low language? You don't need to do that.
Yeah.
Yes, people do talk like that. They don't have to talk like that in your movies.
Right. Right.
You could make that decision and you're yeah. not. You're actively not making that decision.
Exactly.
It's infuriating.
Yeah.
And the fact that he gets a pass is like, it's horseshit.
Mm-hmm. It really is.
He's had the Kubrick crown passed mm-hmm. off to him. Everybody's like, oh, Kubrick is a genius. He wrote The Shining. He directed A Clockwork Orange, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, except he also treated people like complete and utter shit.
Well, it's also the Hitchcock crown, too.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, I mean.
Oh, I sexually assaulted and stalked my leading lady exactly. for several movies in a row. But I loved my wife and I made blockbuster movies. So I guess that means it's fine. I don't know. Ugh. It just goes to show, like, you can really enjoy parts of someone's work and mm-hmm. think that they were groundbreaking or that, you know, enjoy one of their movies while still, on the other hand, like, not supporting that person as a human being.
Yeah, I think that is, like, the tricky part of things. On the one hand, I think, and I think there are valid reasons for doing this, especially, like, you know, for psychological safety. Like, sometimes it is best to just disengage with something altogether.
Absolutely.
But I also think there's, like, a lot of value, and we've talked about this before, in, like, engaging with something that is troubling and, like, understanding, like, what are the good things about it? What are the bad things about it? Why are people still drawn to this? Or what is it about this person that seems to, like, elevate them above, you know, their obvious misbehavior or whatever? I think understanding that makes us better consumers of art in a lot of ways. But you have to be, like, ready and willing to engage with that. And I get it. Like, I have my days where I'm like, no, I just want to watch cartoons. And other days where I'm like, no, I'm going to watch this thing that's, like, going to challenge me or send me down a rabbit hole of, like, reconsidering what I think about this director or writer or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, it's also this terrible double standard where dudes can do the true harm, like real mm-hmm. real life harm. They can write things that are offensive and nothing happens. And then you have, like, some bullshit Greta Gerwig stuff where they're like, she was upset that her coffee was wrong. Mm-hmm. And then everybody's like, well, you can't go see a Greta Gerwig movie anymore. It's like, okay. I mean, I'm making that up. That's a pretend thing. I don't know if there are any allegations against her, but it just seems like such a double standard where people of color, they can, you know, do one bad thing. Like the guy who wrote the X-Men 97 series for Disney. Like, I know I'm going off on a tangent, but they were like, oh, well, he was tough to work with and he had an OnlyFans page that he wouldn't take down. And I'm like, so somebody who maybe has the most progressive writing in 30 friggin' years on the X-Men TV show, making people cry all over the place. My partner, who does not cry at movies, weeping at episode 4 of X-Men 97 of this season. And they're like, nope, that director's out.
Yeah.
Because he's a black man and because he was quote unquote difficult to work with and he had an OnlyFans, a gay black man who had an OnlyFans page who wouldn't be taken down. In comparison to Tarantino, who readily uses the N-word. Yeah. I think Django Unchained actually has a record for the F-bomb and also the N-word in a movie. And this guy can do no wrong. He wrote Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, which was not my favorite film ever in the world, that made millions and millions of dollars. But this guy gets kicked off of writing for X-Men 97.
Yeah.
And, like, that's it.
Well, and never mind, too, like, if you want to get down to it, like, even without the sort of, like, behavior issue, like, how so often, like, if a woman or director of color has one not blockbuster success, I'm not even going to say a failure, but something that doesn't make a kajillion dollars, they're just like, well, I don't, there's all this hand-wringing, I don't know, did they make the right choice? And it didn't, and now I don't know if we can give them other roles. I mean, they tried to do that to Ava DuVernay mm-hmm. after the Wrinkle in Time movie, like, bombed. They were like, oh, well, we don't know about Ava DuVernay. I'm like, it's fucking Ava DuVernay. Come on. Like, she's one of, like, the best modern filmmakers out there.
Yeah.
Like, not everything has to be a home run every time, but I feel like, especially with writers from more traditionally marginalized communities, all of a sudden it's like, you know, there's all this wringing of hands about whether they should have gotten the role in the first place, you know, especially when you're leading a film. And then if it doesn't do 1,000,000,000% well, then it's like, ooh, I don't know. And, you know, they just have to fight twice as hard. You look at, like, a Ryan Coogler, who's finally, I think, overcome that because he's been doing it so long. But how many other, you know,
Jordan Peele had to create his own production
company. Exactly. Yeah. And I was about to say, I can name on, like, you know, one hand. I'm like, okay, so there's Ryan Coogler. There's Jordan Peele.
Yeah.
You know, exactly. Who else? I don't even know.
That's awful. That's yeah. a terrible thing. And like, thank goodness Jordan Peele is like, got his own production company, because people said that after Nope. They were like, mm-hmm. oh, well, Us was good and Get Out was good, but I don't know about Nope. And it's like, dude, this is a masterpiece of writing. And it's so self-referential.
Yeah.
Oh, we're talking about so many other movies that have nothing to do with the garbage, the hot garbage, like, you know, cheese fest that is From Dusk Till Dawn. But that's how I feel about Tarantino. Like, I love Kill Bill. Like, one of my mm-hmm. favorite movies. Pulp Fiction has to be in my top 10 all the time. However, like, every single time I watch it, there's always this caveat in my head where I'm like, well, this guy's also a piece of shit. Like,
yeah,
I'm enjoying this. I'm entertained by this movie. But also, Tarantino's a piece of shit.
Yeah.
Speaking of Tarantino being a piece of shit, I want to talk about that urban legend. It's not really an urban legend because Fiona Apple said it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So not only is Tarantino like a professional piece of shit, he also apparently is unbearable to be around because, according to legend via Fiona Apple, she one time did drugs with Paul Thomas Anderson and Quentin Tarantino. And she's like, I stopped doing drugs after that. I could not do drugs again.
Yeah, she specifically said it was when she was dating P.T. Anderson and they were over at Tarantino's house and they all did a bunch of cocaine. And she said it was so insufferable listening to those two like be so self-aggrandizing. It was like the most miserable night and she stopped doing cocaine after that. This was in an interview in Esquire right before Fetch the Bolt Cutters came out.
I can imagine that their egos would suck up all the air and you would just suffocate.
Yeah,
like, thank goodness she's still alive after night, and that she didn't murder either of them, because it sounds actually terrible. If you've ever heard Tarantino in an interview, he's kind of a space case, like,
yeah,
you know, very scattered, and he talks really, really fast, like, all mm-hmm. the time. But he'll go from idea to idea to idea, and then he's like, but then there's this thing in this movie that I love and this director that I love. And the dude's got an encyclopedic knowledge of film.
Yeah.
However, absolutely. He's also completely, like, I can only imagine what he'd be like on coke.
Oh, God.
And maybe, I don't know, maybe he is on cocaine in these interviews, but I think I would just, like, yeet myself into the mm-hmm. sun before I would want to, like, party with them and just listen to the two of them, like, this movie is amazing. And oh, I remember that you did this thing in this movie. Have you ever seen Four Rooms?
Yes.
Okay. So the last one where they're trying to get the bellboy, Tim yes. Roth, to cut the guy's finger off uh-huh. and they're going to give him a bunch of money and they're talking about how amazing Tarantino is. That is exactly how I imagine the night with Fiona Apple to go.
Yeah.
And just being like miserable
mm-hmm.
in the corner, just like, shut up.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to be high. Please shut up. I think that tells you exactly everything you need to know.
Yeah.
Most yeah. people are intolerable on cocaine. Quentin Tarantino, extra, next level shit, you know?
Yeah, the definition of extra.
I don't even know how bad Paul Thomas Anderson would be. All I can imagine is just Quentin Tarantino's head just getting bigger and bigger mm-hmm. and just filling all empty space in the room before Fiona Apple's just like squished against the wall, like, please, please stop.
Yeah.
Please stop.
Ugh.
I can't take it anymore. Anyways,
yeah,
Tarantino's foot fetish.
Yeah, so, like, I think it's important when we talk about this to just, like, preface this with, like, when we talk about Tarantino's foot fetish, it's not to kink shame.
No.
Because, like, whatever you do you, it's the way that he has brought his particular kink into his film work in a way that I believe violates a lot of rules of consent.
Oh, yeah. No, we're not here to yuck anyone's yum. You do you. Consenting exactly. adults can do literally whatever they want.
Exactly.
However, to write your kink into a yes. movie and ask an actor or actress to participate in that kink and or self-insert
yeah.
into that scene mm-hmm. so that you can participate in said kink, that's not cool.
No.
It's like well known. I think it's like, it's not even a secret at this point. The funny thing would be if Tarantino actually doesn't have a foot fetish and he's just like, I just put it in my movies because people thought I did, so I thought it was funny.
Right, exactly.
I don't think it's that.
I don't think it's that.
Every movie that he can get away with it in, there's either a shot with feet in it, a long shot with feet in it,
mm-hmm.
a close-up of somebody's feet. In this particular movie, Salma Hayek pours tequila down her leg and off her foot, which she puts her toe into Tarantino's mouth, and he sucks on her toe for a while.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, yeah, this is pretty inappropriate.
Mm-hmm.
Especially considering the movies that have come after where you see, like, the obsession with feet.
Yeah.
If it was something where, like, something about the character is like, oh, I've got to, like, I'm obsessed with feet. I'll do anything with feet, whatever. But to put yourself in that role.
Yeah.
And to be like, okay, now pour tequila down your leg and put your perfect Salma Hayek foot in my mouth. So I can suck tequila off your toes.
Yeah.
It's like he made an entire movie around this one fantasy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that he could have this play out. I really hope that Salma Hayek got hazard pay for this.
I hope so.
Because you'd have to pay me a lot of money for the privilege of sucking on my toe if I were Salma Hayek.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because she has perfect feet.
She is perfect.
I know, right?
Perfect human right there.
And to let Quentin Tarantino's weird head suck on my foot. Like, truly, I don't want to yuck anybody's yum, but
yeah.
Also, it's Tarantino, so.
Yeah.
So I don't want anybody, let alone him, to suck on my foot.
Well, yeah. And I mean, you know, when we're talking about we're living now in an age where finally, you know, things like intimacy coordinators are becoming more common on film sets to really make everybody feel safe and affirmed in what they're doing. I just have a fundamental problem with the fact that, like, you have written something in a film and put yourself in a role that you're going to get off on. Like,
yeah.
That is, like, assault?
Yeah.
You know? It's just, it's just not cool, buddy.
Yeah. There's a lot of this movie where it's, like, borderline feels inappropriate. I mean, mm-hmm. Not that you can't have a character who is an assaulter, because that's what Tarantino's character is.
Part of storytelling. Yeah, yeah.
That's his role in this, and that's okay. I mean, there's going to be problematic characters in any story. Mm-hmm. Like, you can't have a movie about a serial killer without Hannibal Lecter. You know, he's a bad guy, obviously. However, to kind of put yourself in that role, once again, that I think is the thing I'm struggling with the most, is to both be a terrible human being
mm-hmm.
in the role and play it yourself,
It blurs all of the lines.
Yes.
You know, it's all of the lines being blurred. You hear the good side of filming situations where you have two actors who are working together on a scene that might be, you know, very vulnerable, very emotional, you know, have some kind of psychosexual element, and being, like, very supportive of each other, you know, really working together as a team to act the scene, you know, to bring that scene to life for the storytelling, but also to make sure that nobody feels taken advantage of, you know, that it is, we are here to do the job of acting. And this just, it blurs all of the lines for me. It's like nothing can be, like, clear cut about it when you have somebody who has written themselves into a scene. It's just not cool.
It'd be like if it came out that Spielberg had, like, an alien fetish and then he was in a movie where, like, he got to suck on an alien's toes.
Yeah.
I know that's a jump, but that, like, he's like, oh, yeah, actually, I'm turned on by E.T. And then he's in a movie where he, like, sucks on E.T.'s toes or something.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, like, gross. And I hope that I didn't ruin anybody's childhood with that because it's not real. I totally made it up off the top of my head. But that's what it would feel like.
Right. Exactly.
Is just really, really gross. And the other thing is, like, E.T. would have to be a real person in that case.
Yeah, not a real thing. Not a puppet.
Yeah, exactly. not made by the Henson Company. This is a weird thing, but I think Tarantino sometimes explores issues of faith in his movies.
Yeah, I think so.
Which
definitely.
It starts off as being kind of a good, important, serious storyline for Jacob, or mm-hmm. Harvey Keitel's character Jake, and his kids, for them to be kind of having this crisis of faith where he's struggling, his wife has died in this terrible car accident, And so he's taking his kids and running away from his job as a pastor because he's like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And then that kind of storyline kind of gets shoved aside because there's vampires. It comes back a little bit, but not really to like a good level of fruition. However, there are a lot of movies, I think, that Tarantino kind of grapples with those issues. Like, specifically, I'm thinking of Pulp Fiction, Reservoir Dogs a little bit, where, like, Pulp Fiction, Jules is, like, struggling with his faith, where, like, all of a sudden on this one day, he's like, oh, shit, I'm a hitman.
Yeah.
I kill people. I almost died killing people. Am I supposed to be doing this?
Mm-hmm.
And it made me think, oh, shit, does Tarantino, like, have kind of a faith complex where he's like grappling with the idea of God or faith in his movies?
Maybe. You know, so Pulp Fiction came out before this, but this movie was written before Pulp Fiction. And actually, Ezekiel's speech from Pulp Fiction was originally in the script for this movie for Jacob.
Oh.
And he changed it.
Okay.
And so I think it's really interesting to think about that. And yeah. I think it's interesting to think about that in context of like, you know, is there something there, you know, because you have these kind of two adjacent movies that are exploring that idea of faith. And I would even argue that although it's less concrete, like less steeped in Christianity, Kill Bill is really about like the faith you put in other people.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
And like what happens when you lose that faith or that faith that you put in someone as your mentor, companion, partner has been utterly betrayed.
Yeah. Oh, man. Now I really want to go back and watch Kill Bill. Oh, that second movie is so good.
Yeah.
For as much as I hate Tarantino, I shake my fist every time. I'm like, damn it, this movie. I love Uma Thurman so much. Yeah. Why did it have to be you? But I want to talk about some fun stuff.
Yeah.
As much as we just talked a bunch of shit about Tarantino. One thing you can say about his movies is that his soundtracks always kick ass.
Yeah. Well, same with Rodriguez.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know whose influence that was since Rodriguez directed and Tarantino wrote in this one.
Yeah.
But yeah, they both are known for having like amazing soundtracks.
Oh, yeah. Like Machete, that one is really good. Spy Kids has a good soundtrack. Like, yeah, I don't know whose influence it was one way or the other, but they always kick ass. In this particular movie, a lot of the movie, in fact, most of the like middle slash end of the movie is a band, like a house band, like quote unquote house band, who's playing inside this bar. And it's awesome. It's a perfect soundtrack for the mayhem that's happening in the bar. And I love that.
Like, oh, yeah.
I'm like, this kind of makes the scene. It wouldn't be nearly as good if it had been anything else.
Oh, it's so true. Yeah, it really puts you in that environment.
The band in this movie is like among my favorite musical choices. The song that they play when Satanico Pandemonium, which is Salma Hayek's character, when she dances, I think perfect choice.
Oh, yeah.
I also think that there are probably thousands of men now who hit puberty when they watch that movie.
Oh, yeah.
In 1996.
Correct.
Like immediately, like she waltzes out. Salma Hayek, who is perfect, beautiful angel, never has done a single thing wrong in her life. And she comes out wearing a very revealing costume with a snake, and she dances with the snake very sensually. Mm-hmm. There's the whole, you know, tequila with the toe scene. It's hot. Like, she looks amazing in this, and she's doing such a good job. I imagine, I was like, oh my gosh, there are so many sexual awakenings. Like, not just men, like any varied gender probably watched this movie and was like, oh shit,
yeah,
like, okay. I've transitioned into a new stage in my life. There's the pre-Salma Hayek snake dance and post-Salma Hayek snake dance.
Yes.
And I am firmly in a post-Salma Hayek snake dance world at this time.
Absolutely. And the band in that scene is an actual band. They're called Tito and Tarantula. They are a Chicano rock band.
Hell yeah.
And they are the ones on the stage, and they are an actual like recording band.
Oh, nice. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, they did a great job. Full marks from me.
Yeah.
Honestly, though, I kind of think that the Titty Twister looks like a fun place.
No, I was going to say the same thing. I mean, yeah, it's like, I don't know, if you're a person of a certain disposition that like is really into like slightly divey, but also like really fun, interesting local bars, especially. I was like, yeah, I'd go there.
Yeah, hell yeah. Exactly. It looks like a ton of fun. Like, if you were like, okay, I'm going to go out and spend some money and I want to dress up a little bit, but I also don't want to be too serious or like go to, you know, a fancy ritzy bar, then you go to the Titty Twister.
Oh, hell yeah.
And there's a bunch of truckers there and there's a bunch of bikers there and like, that's okay. It's kind of seedy. But on the other hand, like the shots are probably really good and cheap, very cheap. And there's women dancing around everywhere. It's not like a strip club where you go and there's like, you know, they're trying to get you to buy a dance or whatever, which like, once again, not yucking anybody's yum. Y'all got to make your money too. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
I just know that when I go to a strip club, I'm like, okay, I got to bring money so I can get a dance. But if I go to the Titty Twister, I can tip the gals.
Yeah.
And watch the show.
It's more like a burlesque situation.
Yeah, exactly. Where you're having a good time. There's a show to watch, but you're also like, getting drinks and stuff.
Yeah.
And you don't have to really dress up.
Yeah.
Although there are no other women in the Titty Twister.
Right.
Aside from the women who are dancing.
Yes.
I think that's by design, but.
Probably. Yes.
It was in the script, so they had to make it that way.
And fun fact, if you watch this movie on television, which, yes, there is a television cut, as I found out a few weeks ago on accident, it is called the Kitty Twister. The Kitty Twister.
Did they change the neon though?
They did. They blurred out the nipples on the neon sign. And they did change like the thing. It was different. Because when they said it, we were like, well, but what about the sign? And oh yes, the sign was different.
Oh my goodness.
And the whole Cheech Marin speech when they arrive.
Oh, about pussy.
All of that. It's kitties. It's all about kitties.
Oh my gosh. Are you kidding me? Wow. That makes it so much worse.
It kind of does. Yeah. That was the one thing that I was like, oh boy, I think you just made it worse.
Yeah. I like seeing Cheech Marin in this movie. He plays a couple of different characters, which that's another kind of trademark of like Rodriguez / Tarantino. He's like using the same actor to do multiple different things. And so I like to see Cheech Marin doing that.
I am curious about that. I would love to know if that is perhaps a hallmark of Mexican or South American like grindhouse movies, because I do know it is a hallmark of comedic elements in Indian cinema.
Oh,
where you will sometimes have a comedic actor who will play multiple roles throughout the movie, and it's kind of there to like tease you a little bit and things like that. There's a movie that we've been working with a little bit, an Indian horror movie, where that is very much the case. You have this comedic actor who is one role adjacent to the main characters and then keeps meeting his own kind of doubles or his own variations throughout the movie.
Okay.
So I don't know if that was just something fun to do because you've got Cheech Marin and why not use him as much as possible, or if maybe that is a nod to another cinematic tradition.
Okay. Interesting. That's good to know. I know that I'm talking about this out of order, but I also wanted to talk about the first scene in the movie. So at the beginning of the movie, you have Michael Parks, who's playing a ranger, which I read that there's like some conflicting things about this, that he could be the same ranger that's in Kill Bill or he could not be, because it's kind of left open-ended as to whether or not he lives or dies. Because while the liquor store blows up, like we never see him leave.
Yeah.
And his car isn't damaged. So who knows? I would imagine if you're hearing explosions in the bathroom, you probably would exit the bathroom.
Yeah, I would think.
But I've never been in an exploding liquor store before. So don't quote me on that. But he comes in and there's this whole initial scene between the brothers, George Clooney and Tarantino, who have taken some girls hostage. They've been seen in the area and this ranger is trying to find them. So the gas station attendant has been told, you better stay cool because otherwise we'll kill you and these girls. So there's this whole sequence. It's like semi-serious until, you know, the brothers come out. Very well shot. Good dialogue. Michael Parks, amazing. Like, I wish I would have seen him in a lot more movies because I think he's a really incredible actor. And then after that, you have these very serious interactions between the brothers and their hostage. They have a hostage in the trunk. And it's really, really, really serious, like good acting, good filmmaking. And then they kind of like turn the entire movie on their head, on its head.
Yeah.
What a swing, you know? And like, as we were watching this movie, I was also talking about Inglourious Basterds, a movie where you have very serious, very good storylines.
Mm-hmm.
The storyline with Shoshana, the storyline with the British spies who are pretending to be German soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And then you throw Eli Roth and Brad Pitt at the problem and it's like, oh, this is not the same movie anymore.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a Tarantino trait or not, because Rodriguez's movies have a tendency to be like very...
They're very straight ahead.
Yeah. And not super, super serious for the most part. More so in like Desperado, El Mariachi.
Yeah.
Less so in Once Upon a Time in Mexico, but more serious, you know, higher stakes filming, but like Spy Kids, Machete, you know. So those movies, very not serious.
Right. It's interesting, too, to look at kind of the character turns. I mean, that is one thing that if I think too hard about this movie, like the ending, the character of Kate is very confusing to me in this movie in general, because we're introduced to her as she's kind of this young woman who does not seem to be like yearning for a more exciting life or bored or whatever. And then about halfway through the movie, she kind of is.
Yeah.
And by the end, like, she and Seth have almost, like, they're almost setting them up for, like, a romance.
Yeah.
Which bothers me for a lot of reasons. And thankfully, they didn't go that direction. But that, like, parting scene between them, and same with Seth. Like, he's this hard ass, you know,
in prison.
He's a very, you know, he's especially up against his brother. Like, he is a very horrible person. And he says horrible things to people. And then by the end, he's kind of like softened a little bit. And I'm just like, what?
Also, Kate tries to save Richie at a certain point.
That made no sense to me.
Yeah.
Like, when, that's one of those things that if I just watch this movie and I'm having fun and I'm just like, whatever. But if I think too hard about that, I'm like, but why? Richie tries to sexually assault her like 6 times in this movie.
Yeah. And like, it would be one thing if we were trying to say that Kate's like a good person no matter what.
Right.
Like, she's just trying to help out these people. But they also were kidnapped at gunpoint.
Yeah.
And threatened with very real violence.
Yeah.
That was probably going to be exacted on them had they not made it to Mexico, which they did by the skin of their teeth.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that was pretty confusing. Like, Scott's character is very, like, straightforward.
Yeah.
But same with Jacob. Like, what incentive would you have to, like, save these people?
Right.
Even being a preacher, it would be one thing if we had like a religious bent to this movie and we said on Jacob's part, like, even though I think that you guys are damned to hell,
I'm
still going to sacrifice myself and help you because I think that you're the only way that my daughter and son will live.
Right.
But he didn't say any of that.
No.
He's just like, okay, well, I got a cross and, you know, we know how to kill vampires, so let's just kill as many vampires as we can.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the whole, like, promise me he'll kill me, you know, thing. Totally fine, cool, but there's a lot of missed opportunities there.
Yeah, I think so.
Flesh out the characters in service of, like, well, the vampires would need to kill everybody.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, because the violence and the effects are so over the top in the second half of the movie, it's easy to overlook a lot of that. Like, I've seen this movie so many times that I don't always catch that, you know, because I'm just like, oh, hey, it's vampire time. Yay. But every once in a while, I just am kind of stopped in my tracks by some of those beats where I'm just like, wait, but why? Like, why would this character be doing this for this other character?
Yeah.
Even in a kind of like, we're all trapped together, band together survival situation. Like, I don't know. The relationship between the brothers and the family, like, they took you hostage.
Right? They put you in danger.
Yeah.
They basically stole you and took you to Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
There's some beats in the final act that definitely, like, we're grinding gears, you know, like, trying to figure out where we're going to go next with this movie.
Yeah.
like the part where they're talking about what they know about vampires, I'm like, oh, this slowed it way down.
Yeah.
The part where Fred Williamson's character is like talking about being a nom, I'm like, what? Mm-hmm. What are we doing?
Yeah.
So there's definitely some issues with the movie, and that's okay because it's a splatter movie.
You know, despite everything, like, it is, like, the fun movie that you put on with your friends or you put on because you've seen it 1,000 times and it's fine. It's just one that if I think too hard about it, I start to get very frustrated.
Yeah, yeah. There's actually a TV show, which I don't think either of us has watched.
No.
We know it exists. We just have never gotten a chance to watch it. So maybe some of those sins are forgiven in that.
Perhaps.
Yeah. Maybe we'll have to watch that and see.
Yeah. So next time we're going to go back into the 80s and watch a film that I have seen numerous times, but it always feels like a bit of a fever dream, which is appropriate because we're going to talk about 1981's Nightmare.
All right. I've never seen it before.
It's weird and fun and interesting, and we showed it at Horrorama a couple of different times. I think that was the first time I saw it, was at Horrorama.
Okay.
And it's one that is memorable, I think. Like, it's one that, like, there are certain scenes that kind of stick with me.
Okay.
It's very psychological, but it's still a slasher.
Okay. All right. An Italian director, so.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's always, got to prepare myself for that. So, yeah, I'm excited. Thanks for listening to Attack of the Final Girls. Find us online at attackofthefinalgirls.com.
And hear bonus episodes at patreon.com/attackofthefinalgirls. We're Attack of the Final Girls on Instagram and TikTok.
Our theme music is by Houseghost and is available on Rad Girlfriend Records.
Be sure to subscribe on your favorite podcasting app so you don't miss an episode, and rate and review on Apple Podcasts so more people can find the show. I'm Juliet.
And I'm Teresa. Until next time, stay scary.